Hey, Abbott, what time is it?
It's time for the Abbott and Costello Show. We're on the air for ABC here in Hollywood.
Well, what are we waiting for? Let's go with the Abbott and Costello Show.
The Abbott and Costello Show, produced and transcribed in Hollywood for your listening and laughing pleasure, with chuckles for the carload and music by Matty Melnick. So hold on to your chairs, folks, for here they are, Bud Abbott and Lou Costello.
Bye. Top of the morning to your faith and me, Gory Methuselah, Glockamora, and the House of Murphy to you.
Wait a minute, what is all this?
You know, this is St. Patrick's Day, and I'm celebrating.
Well, wait a minute. What are you wearing that is green?
Well, that's the old solid gold watch you gave me for Christmas.
Right. Now that you mention that watch, Costello, I bought that in Ireland.
I know it, Abbott. Listen to the watch.
Well, what do you know? Half past Barry Fitzgerald.
Cut this out, Costello. Where have you been all afternoon?
Well, Abbott, gee, I went to a picture show over Hollywood Boulevard. I saw a wonderful picture called When the Howling Coyotes Meet the Riders of the Purple Sage on a Lone Prairie Under a Texas Moon.
What's the picture about?
Two jockeys at Santa Anita. I met a beautiful blonde in the theater, and I said to her, Miss, you are the epitome of womanhood, and the graceful flowing lines of your gorgeous figure are the flawless perfection of femininity. Femininity!
I heard it.
I like the word. Femininity!
All right. Where did you learn so much about women?
I read that small print on a corset.
I say, did you take this girl home?
Yes, when I was kissing her in the hall, I accidentally stuck my thumb in an electric light socket in the wall.
And what happened?
That girl is now a stoplight on the corner of Sunset and La Brea.
How a girl could ever go out with you? With you, a stupid, illiterate, clumsy...
Just a minute, Abbott. I'm not stupid.
You're not stupid. Oh, no. You can't even recite the alphabet.
Yeah, well, listen to this. A, B, C, 1... D-E-F-2, G-H-I-3, J-K-L-4.
Wait a minute. Why are you saying the alphabet that way?
Of course, I learned it off a telephone dial.
Costello, were you born an imbecile?
No. What I am today, I owe to my mother.
Get him out of here.
Get any further involved in nonsense. Here's a thought that makes good sense.
This is your curtain call for Theater USA, the star-studded entertainment produced for your enjoyment by the American National Theater and Academy here on most ABC stations tonight. Theater USA is exactly that. All the glamour and all the stars that brighten the American theater. All the nostalgia, all the excitement that are little old Broadway. True, you don't see the lights that flicker from the Times Building to 53rd Street in the heart of Manhattan, but everything else is there. The great stars, the wonderful laughter, the thrilling music. You'll hear them all from week to week on Theater USA. For example, tonight the lineup of stars will include Albert Spaulding, celebrated concert violinist, and Raymond Massey and Diana Barrymore. Don't miss Theater USA with Diana Barrymore, Raymond Massey, and Albert Spaulding tonight on most of these same ABC stations. Now back to ABC's Abbott and Costello Show.
What's on your mind?
What's on my mind?
Yes.
My mother wants to thank you for that St. Patrick's Day present you sent her. She says it's the cutest little washing machine she ever had.
Washing machine? Mm. You dummy, that's a mixmaster.
You know, I thought it was funny. Every time she put in a tablecloth, she got back 12 napkins.
What did you give your mother for St. Patrick's Day, Lou?
Well, I gave her that garbage disposal and I won on Stop the Music.
You want a garbage disposal on Stop the Music?
Yeah, they're wonderful people on that show, Abbott. They not only gave me the garbage disposal, they also gave me a 5-year supply of garbage.
Costello, you've got to stop hanging around with these quiz shows. You're just wasting your time.
No, I am not.
Yes,
I was on a new quiz show last week, and it's a California frost warning show.
The frost warning show has a quiz show? What's the name of it?
Stop the Weather. You should have seen the prize they had. 50 tons of star-kissed tuna. A smudge pot for every female member of your family. 1,000 sets of General Squeegee tires. A pool table for every room in your house. A carload of strong, hot dog food. A package of Lifesavers. All the iodine your family can drink for 1 year. Your entire house is decorated with flypaper. 500 pounds of coffee from Brazil and a beautiful senorita to have breakfast with you for the rest of your life and serve you the Brazilian coffee.
Who won all this?
I did, but I had to turn it down.
Why?
You know I don't drink coffee.
Why, does coffee keep you awake, Lou?
No, but it helps.
Why do you go around talking like an idiot?
Because idiots go around talking like me.
Well, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Remember, I'm working with you. You want these people to go out of here thinking that I'm a jerk?
Why not? That's the way they came in.
That's a fine way to talk to me. That's gratitude. After all the things I did for you.
What things?
Remember the time you got locked in the cellar and couldn't get out?
Yes.
Who fed and took care of your dog for 3 weeks?
You did.
Who pushed food through a little window all the time you were locked in there?
You did.
And last March, when you disappeared, nobody heard from you. Nobody knew where you were, and nobody had the slightest idea where to locate you. Who finally found you?
The man from the income tax.
I don't blame them for looking for you. I hope you send in your tax return this year.
I certainly did, Abbott. Every American could send in his income tax to Washington. They should do that. It's the patriotic thing to do.
Well, I'm glad to hear you say that.
And besides, they watch you too close.
I hope you fill out your estimated return for next year.
What's that?
Well, that's the part of the income tax blank where it says estimated income for 1949. They want you to guess how much you're going to make next year.
Oh, sure, I filled that out and I sent it in, but I didn't sign my name to it.
Well, you idiot, if you didn't sign it, how will they know who it's from?
Abbott, if they want me to guess how much I'm going to make next year, then let them guess who sent it in. And if they don't stop raising the income taxes, it's going to break up the whole country.
What do you mean?
Well, at the last session of Congress, they took a vote, and I'm proud to say that California was voted the state most likely to secede.
Oh, forget about the income tax. You know, today is St. Patrick's Day.
St. Patrick's Day was caused by income tax.
What do you mean?
Everyone pays their income tax on the 15th of March, don't they?
Right.
Then 2 days later, on the 17th of March, people march in parades all over the country.
Well, what have people marching on St. Patrick's Day got to do with the income tax?
Don't you get it? They have to march. They ain't got enough money left to ride. Uncle Louie! Hey, Uncle Louie. It's Abbott's nephew, folks. Sincerely, it is. What are you so excited about, Norman?
Well, I just rushed over here, Uncle Louie, to tell you they finally caught those two guys.
What two guys?
The two guys that voted to raise President Truman's salary.
I got to set a trap for that. There's a smart kid, Abbott. He learned to skate before he could walk.
Oh, that's silly. How could Norman learn to skate before he could walk?
He had to. When he was born, he was so ugly that his folks kept him locked in the icebox.
You want to be careful to see what you say about Norman. Remember, he's a pretty tough kid. And he comes from a tough neighborhood.
He comes from a tough neighborhood?
Yeah.
Abbott, the neighborhood I come from in Paterson, New Jersey, was so tough that when I was going to school, if we saw a kid on my block with teeth, we were sure one thing.
What was that?
He was either a stranger in the neighborhood or he was wearing upper and lower plates.
You aren't so tough, Costello. Why, for 2 cents, I'd punch you in the nose.
You're the most honest man I know.
Well, thank you, Costello. Della.
It makes my blood boil to hear people talk that way about you. I'll fight anybody to even insinuate that you're dishonest.
Gosh, Lou, I'm sorry I punched you in the nose. You're a real pal. Let's have a drink on our French pal.
Okay.
Well, what would you have?
How about opening that bottle of champagne that you stole off my brother?
Costello, I haven't got the champagne.
Oh, drank it all up, eh?
I didn't take the champagne. All your brother Pat has got is circumstantial evidence, Lou.
No use, Abbott. It's written all over your face.
What's written all over my face?
I don't know. I can't read.
I'm discussing with you. I'm going to leave you and I'll leave California. I can't stand this weather anyway.
Well, Abbott, there's nothing wrong with the weather in California. The California weather is very healthy. It's the people that get sick.
Mr. Costello, I have a message here for you from your Aunt May.
What is it, my good man?
Your Aunt May said to tell you that your Uncle Mike swallowed a half dollar and it's stuck in his throat and he's choking to death. And she wants you to come over Sunday and help get it out.
Well, if he's choking to death, Anna, why is she going to wait till Sunday to take it out?
Well, she figures she won't need the money till then.
If Gabriel Heater is listening in, there's all jokes tonight. That was another one Abbott told us, folks. Hey, Abbott, why don't you go right through with the deal and get your wife on the show?
You mean you'd like to have my wife on the show?
I'd welcome her with relish.
Why with relish?
Because she's got a shape like a hot dog.
She has not. My wife has a gorgeous figure. Not another one like it. When they made her, they threw them all away.
Yes, some guy found it, and he's been making ash cans ever since.
Costello, I'll have you know that my wife has been offered a job at Earl Carroll.
What's the matter with the scrub woman they got now?
Scrub woman? They want her to appear in the finale of the show wearing a bathing suit. And when my wife wears a bathing suit, she attracts plenty of attention.
I'll say she does. She was floating on her back in the water at Santa Monica last Sunday and three Catalina flying boats landed on her chest.
Boys.
Well, hello.
Oh,
hello,
Viola Vine.
Viola Vine, Lou. Gee, Viola, I'm glad you came over tonight. How's about you and I stepping out after the show? You can come with me to the dog show.
You're going to the dog show?
Yes, and I expect to win a blue ribbon with my setter.
Costello, from where I'm standing, you can't miss.
Did it again.
All right, Costello, calm down. She's only fooling.
Oh, Lou, don't be so touchy.
Why, you have a chance.
Come on, you. You know I'm really crazy about you.
Oh,
yes, I am. And to prove it, I'm going to take you to the opera next week. Now, Monday night, they're playing Hansel and Gretel. Tuesday night, they're having Samson and Delilah. Wednesday night, they're having Tristan and Isolde. What night would you like to go?
The night they're having spaghetti and meatballs.
Spaghetti and meatballs. That's the trouble with you. You know nothing about opera, nothing about culture.
Mr. Abbott is right. You need more culture. You should become literary.
But, Gabriel, I was fine.
Look, read good books. Books are your best friend.
Don't lose your place, dear.
Whenever you're lonely, pick up a book. When you feel like stepping out at night, don't do it. Pick up a book. When you feel like going out with a girl, pick up a book. Well, so long. I've got to go now. I've got a date with Gregory Peck.
Viola Vaughn, after all those things you got through telling me about how wonderful books are, you're going out with a man?
Sure, I'm lucky. I never learned to read. So long, cousin.
That's only half the fun, folks. Just as many laughs yet to come. But first, listen to this.
No one now listening, I'm sure, would ever consciously take part in the most contemptible of crimes, kidnapping. And yet, as was forcibly demonstrated on ABC's This Is Your FBI, failure of an individual to report suspicious actions to the police can aid criminals. This warning, a useful protection hint, was offered on one of the broadcasts of This Is Your FBI. And then, to illustrate vividly the need for alertness in reporting suspicious actions, the program dramatized the authentic story of a kidnapper who decided to abduct the daughter of a bookmaker. He figured a man in an illegal profession would be reluctant in seeking the aid of police. Because of the negligence of a girl who caught a glimpse of the kidnappers, the work of FBI agents was greatly hampered. The drama then revealed how the authorities finally succeeded in trapping the criminals. For an exciting and educational 30 minutes, don't miss This Is Your FBI, heard over most ABC stations tomorrow night. And now back to ABC's Abbott and Costello Show.
And now the spotlight turns to Hal Winters, our singing star. Here he is with Matty Malnick and his orchestra.
Now Clancy was a peaceful man, if you know what I mean. The cops picked up the pieces after Clancy left the scene. He never looked for trouble, that's a fact you can assume. But nevertheless, when trouble would press, Clancy lowered the boom. Oh, the Clancy, oh, the Clancy. Whenever they got his Irish up, Clancy lowered the boom, 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 boom. O'Leary was a fighting man, they all knew he was tough. He strutted round the neighborhood, a-shooting off his guff. He picked a fight with Clancy, then and there he sealed his doom. Before you could shout, Tony, they look out! Clancy lowered the boom. Oh, the Clancy, oh, the Clancy. Whenever they got his Irish up, Clancy lowered the boom, 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 boom.
Boom, 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 boom.
Mulrooney walked into the bar and ordered up a round. He left his drink to telephone and Clancy drank it down. Mulrooney said, who drunk me drink? I'll lay him in his tomb. Before you could pat the top of your hat, Clancy lowered the boom. Oh, the Clancy, oh, the Clancy. Whenever they got his Irish up, Clancy lowered the boom, 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 boom.
Boom, 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 boom.
O'Houlihan delivered ice to Mrs. Clancy's flat. He'd always linger for a while to talk of this and that. One day he kissed her just as Clancy walked into the room. Before you could say the time of the day, Clancy lowered the boom. Oh, the Clancy, oh, the Clancy. Whenever they got his Irish up, Clancy lowered the boom, 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 boom. Clancy lowered the boom.
Got a nice voice, that kid?
I know all about
it. He's going places.
I know it.
Thank you, let's just left the building now.
All right, Costello, come on out here. Look, who were you talking to on the phone?
My Uncle Mike. Boy, is he in trouble. My Aunt May just threw him out of the house. He done a terrible thing.
What'd he do?
Well, you know them two towers they got marked his and hers?
Yes.
Well, he used hers.
Right. Costello, I'm ashamed of you. How can you come out here in front of intelligent people and make such a statement? You want everybody to think you're a moron.
Well, if I didn't, I wouldn't have it tattooed on my arm, would I?
Well, never mind that. Our secretary, Viola Vaughn, has been complaining about you, too.
Well, I don't believe it, Abbott. Viola and I are good neighbors. She lives right next door to me, and we're very friendly.
Costello, Viola would make a nice wife for you. Her folks are very rich, and you should do all you can to win her.
Not me, Abbott. Her family's too snooty. Yesterday, her mother was driving along in a 1949 Hudson, and...
A 1949 Hudson? Why, just last week, she bought a 1948 Hudson.
I know, but she had to get rid of it. The ashtrays were full. Anyway, I don't need to marry no rich girl. I'm making plenty of money in my detective business.
Hello, what is your Sam Shovel detective mystery about that?
Well, it's a very intriguing case, Abbott. I call it the case of the cannibal who cooked the long-haired musician, or it was his first square meal.
Well, it sounds terrible, but let's do it.
Yes, I'm Sam Shovel. Sam Shovel, private detective. He needs help tonight. I just left the locker room of the gym of the YAMCA. I'm walking to my little office. I think I'm being followed. I hear footsteps behind me. I quicken my pace. Whoever is following me has quickened his pace. I decide to dart into the alley. A sinister-looking man ducked in the alley with me. I decide to run.
Stop, Sam Shovel, stop.
Listen, you, what's the idea of following me?
Who's following you? When you left the locker room, you buttoned my suspenders to the back of your pants.
anything is liable to happen to you in this business. I arrive at my office. The floor is all covered with fallen leaves. There are twigs all over the floor. This is my branch office. I remember when I started this business in 1928. I didn't have a penny to my name. My clothes were shabby. My shoes were full of holes. That was in 1928. Then a horrible thing happened in 1929. The Depression hit me and I lost everything. That's long enough. I pick up the phone.
Hello? Over there?
Boo-hoo.
Huh?
Boo-hoo, boo-hoo.
Oh, don't cry. Things ain't so bad.
Times like this that I wish my pal, Lieutenant Abbott of the Homicide Squad, was here. There's a real cop. When he goes after a crook, he leaves no stone unturned. Not anybody, but he's turned over every stone in Los Angeles. Abbott is quite a talker. Every time he opens his mouth, he puts his foot in it. One day while he was
taking a bath, and if somebody else starts to walk in...
Abbott sat right down and wrote a big song hit. You've all heard it. All I want for Christmas is my two front toes. Lieutenant Abbott is used to getting hit on the head. He's got
around me, dear.
In his head that he has to comb his hair with.
Tiger.
Yes.
Tiger.
Yes.
Don't ever let anyone come between us.
A shadow couldn't get through.
Hello, Sam Shovel.
It's my pal, Lieutenant Abbott.
Sam, you look mighty tired.
Gee. Come in.
I have all the
baggie for you, sir.
Well, don't bother.
You mean you have all
in the morning. Okay, chump.
For heaven. My shoulders. Guys, I ain't been feeling so good. I got...
Now go close and kiss me.
I'd love to kiss you, honey, but, gee, just when I get set, something happens, I have to unfuck her. Well, I'm ready now. Come on.
I've been looking for you. Where were you all day?
It's a bridal path. Come here. Oh, it's you.
You hit a better class of...
The package wasn't for you.
You were there on a case, I presume?
Yes, a real clever crook.
The bags. We're checking out of here.
Now, calm down, you're just upset because it's your wedding day.
Where's the accordion?
Here, and I'll turn on the radio.
What radio? People putting in and out?
Did that, Sam. You're in plenty of trouble.
No, we're not.
Responsible for sending Machine Gun Magoon to prison, and his mom, James Astarity, is sworn to get
James Astarity, the most dangerous gun mall in the racket. Lieutenant, you say that Dorothy was sworn to get me?
Yes.
All I got to do is for you. She can have me.
There you are. Don't move, coppers. These guns are loaded.
Ma'am, it's her. She's Dorothy.
Lieutenant Abbott, I'm going to kill you.
Please don't kill me, Dorothy. I'm too young to die. I beg you. I beg of you on bonded knees.
Not bonded knees. You're wrong. That's bended knees.
He's right. With all the stuff he guzzles, his knees are bonded.
Please, Dorothy, don't shoot me. Please. Please.
Lieutenant Abbott, I'm ashamed of you. Groveling on your knees like a sniveling coward. Be like me. I'll tell her a thing or...
Sam Shovel, I'm going to kill you, too. Now, what were you going to say?
Abbott, you're taking up the whole floor. Move over, give me more room to kneel down.
Dorothy, please, Ferris. We'll do anything to make amends. Anything you say.
Yes, Dorothy, you shouldn't be mad at me. I think you're beautiful. Come on, let you and me kiss and make up.
What do you mean, kiss and make up? We just met.
Well, let's kiss and make up for all the time we lost.
Well, I don't know. My boyfriend, Machine Gun Magoon's in prison. And I am kind of lonesome.
Viola, why not let Sam cheer you up? He's quite a lover, you know.
How good would you say you are, Sam? You know, in my mob, we rate the guys according to the number of girls that are crazy about him. If a guy's got 6 girls crazy about him, he's called a cannon. 5 girls, he's a shotgun. 2 girls, he's a revolver. Well, Sam, how do you stack up?
Take hands with a water pistol.
Oh, Sam, you're cute. maybe you could be the guy to take Magoon's place. I'm going to give you a chance. Come here.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to kiss you a couple of times. How's that?
That's what I call a high dramatic kiss.
A high dramatic kiss?
Yes, he went from first to second without shifting.
Sam,
I think you got her.
Huh?
I think you got her, Sam.
Yes,
play up to her, and she may not kill us.
Dorothy, if I can make you forget Magoon, will you spare our lives?
Sam, I'll accept your proposition. If you can give me a kiss that'll make me forget Magoon, I won't shoot you.
And you won't shoot me either?
It's a deal.
Sam.
Sam, I'm defending.
That's me.
Excuse me. Go ahead.
All right. Sam, I'm depending on you. Put everything you got into this kiss. It means our lives.
Don't worry, Lieutenant. They don't call me Love Lip Sam for nothing. Come here, Dorothy. Well, Dorothy, what do you think?
Ladies and gentlemen...
Wait a minute, just a minute. Two shots, please. He ain't just going to kill me off alone. He goes with me. Now, Viola. It says here, two loud shots.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to hear a detective show next week, tune into The Fat Man, Ellery Queen, or This Is Your FBI.
Oh, you get out of here, will you?
Now, before Abbott and Costello have their final fling, we bring you one more thought on this subject. The saying goes that most fat men are good-natured. There are people, though, who say they have to be because they can't fight and they can't run. But Brad Runyon is one fat man who's done a lot of running, more than his share of fighting. He's the private detective on The Fat Man, heard Friday nights over most ABC stations. When master detective writer Dashiell Hammett conceived the character of Brad Runyon, he saw in his mind's eye a tough criminologist who tipped the scales at 241 pounds, who appeared slothful, but could move at a speed almost equaling his lightning thinking. Vast numbers of listeners make the Fat Man program a Friday night listening habit. So for exciting entertainment, join the millions hearing Dashiell Hammett's Fat Man when it's on the air tomorrow night over most of these ABC stations. Now back for a final word from ABC's Abbott and Costello show.
That was quite an interesting case you did tonight. Would you like to tell the folks what your Sam Shovel case was for, case for next week is about?
You really got you, didn't he?
Would you like to tell the folks what your Sam Shovel case for next week is about?
Yeah, yes, I would.
That's right.
Folks, next week I will do a murder story. I call it the case of the young bride who set fire to her 60-year-old husband's beard, or there's no fuel like an old fuel.
That's it, folks, and our writers are working on it now. Our writing staff is headed by Eddie Foreman with Paul Conlon, Pat Costello, Martin Ragaway, and Len Stern.
Our sound men, I don't know. our producer is Charles Bender. Be sure to be with us next Thursday.
Good night, folks.
Good night, everybody in Patterson.
Good night.
Listen each Thursday night at this time for another great Abbott and Costello show, just transcribed in Hollywood. Be sure to stay tuned for the outstanding entertainment which follows throughout the evening on this ABC station.